Is there one of these, or maybe it's not in part of your own wheelhouse, but is there one that I guess if you were to have someone completely new that says, hey, I'm really interested in blockchain security, I want to get into this Web3 world, I know this is totally subject to bias, right? But which of these might be the most, here's the friendliest thing that you could tangibly play with and wrap your head around this thing? Is there one?
I will say probably Ethereum, right? Okay. You all agree? I believe so.
Does Ethereum have some stumbling blocks on those gas fees or the time? Or what level of commitment does someone need to dive in?
There is actually not a lot. So you don't have to know a lot how the underground works. So basically there are so many tools. It has been there for like some years already. And there are so many tools that can help you develop smart contracts for Ethereum. You can even use Python if you want. There is Viper. So you can use Solidity, which is the standard language that we use. At the end, everything translates to the same. Everything it gets compiled. It translates to EVM codes. And it gets executed. So you can use whatever language you want, as far as you have like a parser and a grammar interpreter, that's it basically. So there are so many tools, so I will say that's the easiest one to start with.
I would actually argue that Near is also so friendly. I don't know if it's more friendly or not. I mean, apart from that address, human readable address is tough thing. It's actually supported in assembly script and Rust, so it has a less barrier to entry. Like in terms of ease of use, it actually like the organization has this academy that they have, which introduces like the whole concept of Near and the blockchain to like normal users, not even developers. And they have also the university where developers actually learn stuff, and they have their own certifications, so you could actually get onboarded to the blockchain itself through actual learning. So like stuff that is accredited by them basically. So I would say that's also making it so friendly. Like I think friendliness is like the number one value for Near. The second is scalability. So as opposed to most of the other blockchains, they look for scalability first. So yeah, that's, I think I could argue that they are both like very friendly in their own ways.
Yeah,
that's true. Regarding the Cosmos wasn't basic blockchain, I think that everybody here agrees that Solana is the hardest one to learn. But well, what happens, even those technical limitation, one key aspect is that at least for us in security, when we try to approach a new technology, we look at first how this technology works. I think that one key aspect here is the more documentation we have, it's easier for developers and also for hackers to understand how the smart contract is created and how to try to look for different angles. So the more you understand the code, the more you understand the protocol behind that, how it should supposed to work and not to work, it's easier for a beginner to understand what are the vulnerabilities.
I wouldn't call Solana an easy blockchain because I think it's the most low level of the one that we're discussing today, which kind of fits into this decentralized operating system narrative. Because like, if you think about it, like Python is always gonna be slower than C. Then again, C is definitely more difficult language than Python. So, you know, there's a trade-off between you know, user friendliness and performance of the blockchain. Now, that's not to say there aren't any tools that can't, you know, make it a bit easier for especially developers to come up with new programs and smart contracts. So there's this thing called Anchor framework for Solana, which is kind of, you know, like basically a language framework, like if you think of, you know, Node.js or Laravel or any other framework for any like .NET or for any other language. That's pretty much what it is, because it's abstracts several you know, key features for the developer, so they don't have to worry, say, about you know, how to write an access control function, because the template is provided. You just have to, you know, plug the right data into it. So if you have, you know, like a struct with, you know, several fields, you can then you know, define what fields should be checked when the contract is called. So if the criteria is matched, if the data is considered valid, only then it's going to be processed. And if you want to implement it yourself, you might end up, you know, making a mistake, especially if it's so low level, then, you know, even though you match the right data, you might do a transformation that, you know, kind of conflicts with what you did previously. And well, the whole, you know, access control function is pretty much useless because of one little mistake that might be pretty difficult to spot. And like, I know of one security tool, like vulnerability scanner for Solana, which is still in the works. So like, relying on just automated tools, which I guess we can all agree is not enough to be certain. Like, just like in Web 2, you can obviously buy Bird Professional or Nessus license and just run automated scans, but I guess we all know just, you know, how effective they are, especially considering that most of the, you know, most critical vulnerabilities are in the business logic. Mm-hmm. And those won't be catched by automatic scanners, because well, it's not like super intelligent AI to understand the code and try all business cases.
You were chatting about like, oh, is there a parallel of Burp Suite or Nessus or some other traditional, again, quote unquote, security tool? Is there room for that in the Web3 space? Is it significantly lacking? Is it something that you as Halborn want to pour into? What does that look like if there is security tooling to make this more natural for developers or for users or for anything?
Yeah, for example, in case of Ethereum, we have so many automated tools to perform scans. Are they reliable? That's something we have a question about. As Piotr said, basically doing an automated scan is not enough for a smart contract audit. You need to understand the logic behind it. You need to start looking deep at the code, and you will be impressed on how many issues we can find just by looking at the code that automated tools cannot find. It is amazing, yeah. So for example, on Ethereum we have Slither, which is a static analyzer tool. We have as well some formal verification tools that will basically check the code, perform some mathematical operations, and decide whether or not an invalid input can cause issues on the smart contract, which is kind of like AI, I will say, probably. And yeah, we have so many as well, but we always rely on the same, doing manual.
Yeah, I think it's the same in our case as well. For us, however, there are like vulnerability scanners for Rust code itself that checks Rust itself. So this is also a vulnerability class that applies to smart contracts, because at the end of the day, it's always Rust, right? So whatever, if there's an overflow, it's going to affect this contract. Like, it's language specific, but it actually applies to smart contracts as well. But another aspect that actually makes auditing smart contracts, I would say, more efficient than normal Web2 auditing that's not automated, like manual, is that we always have access to the source code because of the like open source nature of the blockchain. So you always have more visibility to what could be happening like behind the scenes. That makes the audit always more efficient than just black box or even gray box pen testing in Web2. So yeah, that's another take that actually helps us as auditors and as pen testers of offensive security engineers, whatever.
I like that you have the source code, as you mentioned, though. That open source aspect, I hope, really adds to a lot of, hey, the manual work, putting human eyeballs on it.